Hola.
Hola.
Buenas noches.
Buenas noches.
Buenas noches, buenas noches. Gracias por estar aquí en esta entrega. ¿Es la última? No, no es la última, ¿no? De la serie.
Sí.
¿Es la última?
Sí.
Ok. Bueno, pues sí, esta es la última entrega de la serie que preparamos para ustedes en la maestría de escritura creativa en español de NYU. La serie de eventos que cada semestre celebramos aquí en el King Juan Carlos Center. Hace unos meses conocí a Sharon. Bueno, hoy nos estamos viendo en nuestro cuerpo, pero hace meses que estamos hablando, dándole forma a un proyecto del que les he hablado ya en clase. Va a llevarse a cabo el semestre que viene para los interesados de los dos años, ¿no? Es un proyecto colectivo que estamos, al que le estamos dando forma entre los estudiantes de Interactive Telecommunication Programming de TISH y los estudiantes de nuestra maestría, ¿no? Estamos todavía trabajando los detalles de cómo va a funcionar esa colaboración. Esta es la primera de una serie de iniciativas que estaremos trabajando en la maestría, buscando nuevo caminar hacia otros espacios de eso que llamamos escritura creativa, ¿no? Otros lugares donde podemos contar nuestras historias. Tenemos esta noche presentándonos estas pequeñas maravillas a Sharon de la Cruz. Sharon de la Cruz es una narradora, educadora y activista neoyorquina. Sus prácticas e investigaciones están enraizadas en la pedagogía STEM, el arte y la justicia social. Según Kirkus Review, su primera novela gráfica, I'm a Wild Seed, publicada por Street Noise en el 2021, es un potentísimo graphic memoir sobre la formación de la identidad de una mujer queer que retrata de manera efectiva los miedos y el júbilo que causan el sujeto marginalizado el descubrimiento de su propia marginalidad. De la Cruz es graduada del programa de maestría del Interactive Telecommunication Program, donde actualmente enseña. Recibió la beca Fulbright, la Processing Foundation Fellowship y una residencia T. Actualmente es la Red Barnes Teaching Fellow en ITP en NYU. Bienvenida, Sharon.
I'm going to speak English tonight, but any questions or conversations, I understand Spanish and I speak Spanish. I just don't do well at describing art in Spanish. So I'll be speaking in English, but whatever question you have in whichever language, don't worry, I can understand it. So hi everyone, I'm Sharon. That's me. basically, as Rita said, you know, my work is in the intersection of art, social justice, and like STEM pedagogy, and I'll talk about what the heck that means anyway. And I am also obsessed with cats, memes, and very Dominican humor, and we'll talk about what that means too. But I'm gonna set this conversation off with a little bit of context to how I came to make the art that I make, but also how my teaching practice is also my art practice as well. So I make comics, I make different types of art, but then also my teaching practice is very much an art too. I think teaching is an art. I put this up because I think this tweet says a lot about me, and I'll just read it verbatim. If you don't know who Moses Sumney is, he's an incredible singer and artist, and just really beautiful. But anyway, he goes, "Not everything a black artist does has to be Afrofuturism, you know? Sometimes it's just a black person living and creating and not dying." I know you're excited to fire off your new woke vocabulary, but chill. So that's usually, I think that's like where my heart is, right? Where I'm just, I'm making art and and I'm black and it's fine. Like, and I make things with a lot of humor, probably because I'm traumatized, but you know, we can talk about that later too. And then also James Baldwin has this wonderful quote that says, societies never know it, but the war of artists with their society is a lover's war. And they do, at their best, do what lovers do, which is to reveal the beloved to themselves, and with that revelation, make freedom real. And also, you know, lovely James Baldwin, I don't have to explain him to you, but he's really great, and a lot of the underlying themes also of, I think, my current work has to do with freedom. So also, just some more context, I believe in joyful resistance. I also believe in being very angry. There's a lot of things to be angry about. But joyful resistance, you know, against the white gaze, almost like an unexpected rebuttal. And then, you know, I am in the business of teaching, so it's really important to understand this space as a historically white institution, right? And what it does and does not provide to BIPOC students. And so just like being real about being in this space and why I teach in this space and how the history of this space affects how I teach. So that's why we talk about culturally relevant STEM pedagogy, is the way I teach math, science, STEM, whatever you want to call it, or even interactive art, is rooted in pedagogy and the practice of teaching in a very, in a way that invites people and invites their culture in, right? I'm not trying to tell you what's math. I'm trying to point out where math is around you. Seymour Papert was an MIT professor. If you haven't read already, he wrote Mindstorms, which is a really, really fabulous book. And a lot of the visual coding languages that you see now, like P5 or Scratch, is all based off of a visual programming language called Turtle that he created. And so he really thought about the relationship to computers and what that new relationship would be. And he predicted cell phones, which is really fun. So when you read his book, he's just like, mini computers in the back of your pocket. And I'm like, yes, this is really great. So, you know, he has he talks a lot about the pedagogy in the classroom, whereas Paulo Freire, right, talks about meeting people outside in the corner, folks who historically like maybe just don't like have a formal education, and how do you educate, how do you teach? And so both, you know, are really thinking about accessibility, but in different ways. One is like within the four walls of the university, and then one is like outside, right? Like meet people where they are. And then this is my personal favorite, Octavia Butler. If you don't know her, really amazing writer, African-American sci-fi writer, and a lot of my work is just trying to be her, basically. I just want to be her when I grow up. But anyway, if you haven't read any of her work, I would start with Wild Seed, and actually I'm a Wild Seed was inspired by her book. So again, culturally relevant pedagogy, I'm really like thinking through what is like that, what's interactive, but also before we even get it interactive, it's like, what is STEM and who gets to be technology and who gets to see math and science in their culture? And honestly, if anybody would have told me at 15 that my hair is a fractal, I would have freaked out. You know, I would be like, wow, my hair is math. Like literally I grow math from my head. Shit, that's amazing. But no one told me that, right? Instead they told me that math is like this thing that if I did art, I would not do math, right? Like you're not that thing. So when I talked about math, I really like try to think of how do I really get people excited to think about STEM in their bodies, in who they are, and especially in identity, which is, you know, that's a whole other presentation, but really thinking about how we can just like celebrate what the hell is on you and in your culture and who you are, instead of trying to, I guess, tell you what this like weird Western idea of what math and science is. You grow it out of your head, it's wild. This is another example of when like culturally relevant pedagogy, and this was I think in 2017 or 18, I can't remember. But anyway, this was when I was teaching at Princeton University, and I was in charge of a creative tech lab, and I created something alongside the LGBT center called Hack the Drag. And basically, this is like my love letter to RuPaul using STEM. And I decided, I was like, well, what if we can teach people the basics of circuits using drag? So I'll show you some examples of that. So basically, like, really getting people excited to what would be like this like off-putting thing like circuits, and showing them that like actually we can, again, using the technology as a tool, not as the story itself. The story's already there. The drag is the story, right? Like that's the story. But how do you use perhaps technology to like heighten that story a little bit? I'll just show you a little bit of this. And I realized, and maybe I can show you some performances. So I got a little wild. And this is a weekend-long hackathon with just like folks. Well, that's a professional drag queen. And then we had students also perform and basically use what they learned with circuits to create new costumes all in one weekend. So we started Friday night, and then Sunday afternoon we're performing. So that was fun, right? So just creating, and honestly, when I created Hack the Drag at Princeton, I got a lot of microaggression, like, I guess, really, yeah, just like really like weird microaggression, like setbacks or ways in which folks were like, how is this STEM, right? Because I was in what was formerly a group called, or is called, the Council of Science and Technology, and then they're seeing a drag show. Oh, and folks were not excited. Some folks were not excited. There were folks who were excited, but there were clearly folks who were not excited about that idea. And that's when I knew I was doing something right, right? I was like, oh, you don't like that? Great, right? one is because all of the students that weekend, none were STEM students. None of them were STEM students. There was actually just two who were my students who came because they loved me, right? And I was like, please come and help us. But the rest of them were not. They were like either theater majors or basically other majors that had nothing to do with STEM. And we got them to create circuits and think about constructing things and telling a story in drag. But they loved the drag so much, and they loved the idea of storytelling or performance as storytelling, that they were willing to like figure it out. And that's, I think, where the juice is. And then I put this here because this New York Times article that came out yesterday is like, computer science students face a shrinking big tech job market. It's like really sad. One is really sad, but I put it up here because honestly, and that's the wrong slide. Actually, because ITP, which is the Interactive Telecommunications Program, yes, we are a tech program, but I like to describe it as like tech leadership, mainly, right? It's like, yes, we can teach you the tech, but how to tell stories through tech, I think that's a little different. And we're in the business of that, of using technology as the medium, not the story itself, right? The story itself is the drag. The story itself are, you know, really thinking about how can the technology aid in building up something else? But the tech itself is what does this, you know, is what, that's scary when you just study tech, at least in my opinion, right? But when you study like thinking and making stories, you can take that anywhere. The tech, I can, you know, and I'm not trying to downplay tech school because it's great, I teach in it, right? I'm not trying to downplay that, but when you think about technology as a career and just like coding as a career, you're gonna get this, right? You're gonna get a job market that may or may not be there. But when you think about technology as like thinking through designing experiences, designing stories, and honestly designing just like better human experiences, designing experiences where we actually connect, that's when you actually, the job market doesn't matter that much. So that's ITP, Interactive Telecommunications Program, again, where I teach. And just to move forward the presentation, here's a little bit of what you'll see in ITP. So that's actually a wooden mirror that moves, that literally like mimics you. Then we have really little cuties playing with 3D meshes. Random things. And this is all out of context on purpose, because this is what happens at ITP. It's literally like creating experiences. This is woven with like conductive yarn. You get lots of smiles. You get that. I didn't even know this was in the website. I just found my face somewhere. So you get a lot of these kinds of experiences with, where people are not just passively working with the tech, but they're like, their whole bodies are like involved in the technology. And that's where, for me, that's what makes ITP a little different than the other tech schools, or like why I love this kind of technology, is because it's like this full body experience, right? It's not this passive experience. And so, just really quickly, I do invite you all to the winter show that's gonna happen December 18th and 19th. It's free. It's in the Brooklyn campus on 370J. I can send you all a link to this, but it's totally free, but you do need an RSVP. So just know, I'll send Rita the link and then she can send it to you all. But yeah, so I am gonna just show you, one is I have a shitload of tabs that I'm gonna have to just like go through, unfortunately, but I'll start with me, and then what I'm gonna do is just like end in a survey of just like other works that I really love that's interactive. Let's look here. So maybe I'll start here with Ferguson. So this is like early work of an interactive sculpture that I created. This is like laser cut gun that I put together. And then on the end is a zoetrope, and a zoetrope is like a manual animation piece. And so inside of this gun is a circuit, and when you pull the trigger, the trigger is connected to a motor that then is connected to the zoetrope. So then you pull the trigger and then the zoetrope turns basically, and then you can see the animation that's inside. And at this point, so this is called hashtag Ferguson, and I created hashtag Ferguson in 2015. And this was when, like, you know, Mike Brown was shot, Ferguson was happening. And at that time, it wasn't like main media news. This was like right before it was like super main media news. And I was just watching what was happening in Ferguson through like live stream. And it was super awkward and it was weird. And I was in my second year of grad school and we're drinking like matcha lattes, right? And no one's talking about this. And I was like, this is very awkward and this is super, super weird. So I decided to, with some like new skills that I learned at ITP, AKA circus, I was like, okay, I can create an experience. And so what I ended up doing is drawing out Mike Brown being shot. And so let me just play this. And what you'll notice too is that in the video, the gun looks a little different. One of the things that I'm always excited about is prototyping, right? And so I have an idea. I couldn't execute the idea in this way. This is actually the second iteration of it. But the first idea, I just like totally went into like a Halloween store shop, hacked a gun, and then like put a circuit in it. And the point is that not that it was like the best looking thing, right? Like this was the second version. It wasn't the best looking thing, but the experience, again, the idea of like, I understand visuals, right? And like what would tease people. And I didn't have to tell people, hey, pull this trigger. Even if you've never held a gun before, you know what to do with it. Very unfortunate, right? And so understanding the mechanics of image. And I didn't have to tell anyone what to do with it. They can just pick it up. And the surprise was the thing was spinning and they were like, oh crap. Like they didn't know what to expect afterwards, but the idea of a gun, people were more than happy to pick it up. And then I'll show you this guy. This was, so I created this. This is called, so this is basically kind of climate alters is what this is called. And the idea here was I was thinking about climate change a lot. Still thinking about climate change a lot. And then thinking about my relationship growing up to climate change and like how the consequences of like being poor growing up and how that actually makes you more savvy and have a better relationship to earth in some ways and in other ways not. But in what I was thinking about is, okay, I grew up in a Puerto Rican mom, so like a lot of Catholic saints around my house. And then at the same time, I had a very Cuban dad who had a lot of like, sprinkled a lot of like Santeria around, right? And you know, hello diaspora, so you know what that means, right? Like it's just like one in the same there. But I was thinking about a lot of like my dad's relationship to the deities in Santeria, and then I thought about Yemaya and what would it mean to like pray to stop climate change or like to pray to climate change. And so I created this piece. One of the things that I did is I actually shaped Yemaya's dress by the global temperature data from 1880. Yeah, from 1880. And it was like, at that point it was like 2000 and maybe like 18 or 17. Yeah, 17 here. So I took this data and I actually made her dress out of it. So all of these are just data points. So I wrapped those data points into a shape that ended up being like this cone shape of her dress. And then I created this altar. Again, so totally into experiences. After this, you know, creating this like icon, it's my very first icon. I showed it to my mom, still a practicing hardcore Catholic, and she knew it was an icon, and I was like, yes. So that means that if like my art career doesn't happen, you know, like I can always just create icons, which is just a really nice to know that I have a backup plan. but created this icon. She totally got the idea of like icon and to pray to, and that's honestly the person I'm trying to impress the most. So I was like, yeah, we got it. and put that together. And again, the idea of like what's being revealed based off of this temperature data too. I don't know if you like noticed, but at one point when it's peaking really high, the temperature data, you can see her butt. So again, just kind of like what's being revealed and not in this body. And you know, I have to infuse some humor in this some way somehow. So that was that. And last but not least, at least for like this kind of work, is this was my thesis project actually from ITP, and never in a million years would I think that I was gonna like make anything functional, because most of my art is like very static and comics and cartoons. But again, once you learn some of these like new tools, you realize, oh, you can insert yourself in places. Again, these are tools that help you just be able to imagine not just solutions, but like experiences as well. And so for my thesis, this was again in 2015, and this was when like about 40,000 like unaccompanied minors that year crossed the US-Mexico border. And I knew I wanted to highlight something about it. Long story short is I ended up working with Catholic Charities in New York City and really thinking through the process of an unaccompanied minor seeking asylum. And I thought that was interesting because it literally is child crossing border, you know, they'll go into some sort of like, get into some sort of group. So let's say you're in Catholic Charities, you're under Catholic Charities, and their paralegal teams have, from the minute they meet you, they have about like basically 45 minutes to interview you and plead your case in front of a judge. That's like the most horrifying thing. When I realized that, I was like, this is a problem, right? Like 45 minutes to plead someone's case. We know what it looks like a range of trauma. Trauma can be either someone not talking or someone talking a lot and then everything in between, right? And you talked about little children, and I said, damn, in 45 minutes, you could really traumatize someone very, very fast. And they're just trying to get as much information as they can from the child because they have to plead a case, right, for asylum. So the things that aren't said and the things that are said, both are really, really, really important. So in this case, what I ended up doing is with Catholic Charities, I created this like drawing app based off of like an art therapy practice of like drawing your house and what it means that when, cuando tú dibujas tu casa, like what does it mean that now I have, like I'm drawing my house, and not that we're like trying to psychoanalyze anyone, but rather could we give agency to these young people to talk about where they just came from, what their situation looked like. So I'll show you just a little clip of that.
Ricardo, hola, yo soy Jenny, trabajo para Caridades Católicas. Es una organización de abogados, aunque yo no soy abogada, soy asistente legal.
Brillante tu amiguito, te pasaste de la cuenta.
Tengo un juego que vamos a usar. Está aquí en mi tableta. Entonces, como puedes ver, hay dos amiguitos aquí. Y puedes empezar aquí dibujando tu casa. ¿Está bien? ¿Te gusta dibujar? Sí. ¿Vives en un pueblo o en una ciudad?
Una ciudad.
Una ciudad, pero con árboles. Ok, perfecto. Entonces hay tres personas viviendo en la casa. ¿Quién es ella?
Mi mamá.
¿Tu mamá? ¿Y él?
Mi tío.
So I'll stop it there, but giving agency, right? Being able to like ask questions and say, oh, who's this, who's that? And having the young person participate in what would essentially be an answer was super important in this case. So again, my love for drawing, having some art therapy research behind this, and then putting this in front of actual unaccompanied minors, which unfortunately I couldn't, you know, obviously for ethical reasons, cannot show you their drawings, but it was actually used in some of the intake. And you, obviously I don't have any clear evidence that it made a difference, but I do have paralegals who did tell me that it at least created a less tense dynamic between paralegal and child. And that's when I, you know, and that's the small little thing. I was like, if I could even just like bring that down a notch just for those 45 minutes, I'm happy with technology, right? Like the technology has done something. Again, just to, my first priority was not to re-traumatize children. I will go back here, and then, you know, I'll end this section with, this is a lot of what I do, which is just like comics and image making, and then using drawing and technology to think through, you know, just like lovely things like this, right? Where you just like, how else can I say this? And I might be, you know, I'm revealing that I'm obsessed with drag queens as well, but you know, just the idea of being able to use image making and like technology to to just like really talk about everything that's just messed up around here. So again, this is me, but I also wanted to perhaps also think through other folks. And so I have a couple of different examples of interactive art that I love. This is called Terminal 3, and it basically puts you in the shoes of law enforcement, or basically border patrol, and you have to interview folks who are quote unquote may look Muslim. And so the idea is you are border patrol and you're asking and answering some questions. Again, can HoloLens, can it itself provide more empathy? No, right? Like the technology itself, no, but the stories that come around it and use the technology to think about literally like the lens in which you're looking at someone or interrogating someone, yes. This is Lajane McMillan, who also uses like black
and what?
Let me look. Let me go back. Basically, Lajane here is one. She went to NYU to just like the IDM program, and I really love her work because she has something called the Black Movement Library, which really looks at like black bodies online. And a lot of what we know about TikTok is like the co-opting of like black bodies or black movement, right? And then a lot of like white creators using that to gain money. And so she really looked at that and looked at how just really how racist the technology is to create avatars and to create movement and actually to like archive black movement, which I thought was pretty interesting. And let me see if I can grab onto, yeah. So we'll start here. And she's just gonna talk a little bit about the existing technology to make you like less black, more Asian, less Latino. Fun times. These things actually exist.
Location, which also attaches to, which is a plugin for DAZ 3D. And essentially, it's really good for recompiling faces by uploading your pictures to the space. However, you can see on the right here, with all of these different sliders, there are a lot of problems that arise. You can see that at the bottom half here, they've reduced a lot. They created a lot of different problematic sliders for African, East Asian, South Asian, and European. So basically, I have a lot of questions around what software, where did they get this information from? For this is what makes you look more quote unquote African or more East Asian or more South Asian or more European. Where are you getting this information from? And also, how can you sort of take all of this range of data for all of the different ways that somebody can look, a person can look into one slider? But also, interesting enough, you can also see that as the features become darker in skin tone, they also associate that with feminine, quote-unquote feminine and masculine characteristics of the face. So you can sort of see how these biases are implemented way more clearly than in a lot of different other softwares when it comes to how software developers see the body, see our faces and how we are.
So, didn't want to do that. Anyway, so again, this is pre-existing, this is existing software today that is using really hideous constructs of what specific identities look like and how I can make you look more East Asian, more black. And again, Lajane just says it so much better, but just thinking through, these are already existing technologies that are reinforcing those weird binaries, or just reinforcing this weird idea again of who looks Muslim or who doesn't, right? Who looks Latinx, who doesn't. I also have, let me skip through this one. I also have Ali Santana. He's also faculty, or he's a teaching resident at ITP, again, using sound. And let me see if I have his. I'll go back to it, but I have a clip of him basically VJing and DJing as his performance. And then actually I can show you this as well. This is Bora Yoon, and she used some gerrymandering maps to create this orchestra, to create this piece of music. And so again, using maps and using data and then creating like generative art out of it. This is Tahir Hemphill.
What happens here is you have a map of the world, and every pin in the map represents some place on Earth a rapper mentions.
The Mapverse Delight is a sculptural data visualizations app. It was created for the 5G Intent Challenge.
The interface is a globe, and when you hold up your device over a specific AR marker, you see the planet. It's bristling with these pins, and as you tap those pins, you can hear a sample of the lyrics that the rapper mentioned.
It shows how rappers represent cities, their neighborhoods, and their streets, and how they talk about it.
The kids are really good at asking the first questions, like, where's my, you know, representation in this? And then you have to start explaining to them, well, it's a database, and this is how we built it, and no databases that were complete. They start understanding what data science is about. It's very real that the sort of high bandwidth solutions that 5G provides definitely remove the bottleneck that we had to deliver this real-time search. Now we can really figure out what can teachers and students really do with it.
Sorry about that Verizon logo. well, you know, again, how do you teach someone about data sets? How do you even get someone to care about data sets, right? Using rap lyrics. Beautiful, right? We're always repping our city, right? So understanding, again, like the culturally relevant pedagogy in that to get folks to think more deeply about actually the science that it takes. Like, where am I? Oh, maybe you have to actually insert yourself in. Even that act, I think, is pretty beautiful and brings us closer to having a relationship to the technology. Again, being less passive and more active. But they have to, you know, but folks need to see themselves in it. And that's, I think, one of the core messages is how do you see yourself in this technology that, you know, honestly has been pretty white and cis and male for a very, very long time. How do you see yourself in it? So I think this was just a good example of folks then young people asking questions of, literally, where am I? And then you're just like, you gotta put that in yourself. And that, I think, is like, that's the spark of a relationship between yourself and technology. Just to kind of wrap this up, I do want to show a couple more things. I had a couple of brilliant thesis students last year who I think just made really incredible work. I was speaking to folks earlier and talking about how as a teacher, sometimes the technology that folks use, I'm like, you know, I want to like shake my head. But as a teacher, you can't just like blanketly shake your head. You have to just kind of like step back and say, okay, there is new technology, you are using it, and then maybe just like think critically about the why. Why are you using this tech? And so I had one student who from the very beginning was like, I want to use AR. And I was like, ooh, all right. So I had to set my little feelings aside around AR, and I just kept asking, why? Why are you using AR? And I think, you know, I'm very happy that she proved me wrong, because AR can actually be like super wonderful. And I think she did just a really wonderful job at that. I'm gonna make this maybe a little bigger, and I'm gonna just forward it in here. So,
another iteration that I tried was a semicircle. It didn't work quite well.
So this is Rashri, and what she was thinking about was typeface in AR. And when she brought up this, you know, idea to me, I was like, Rashi, I don't know, I'm not convinced. Like, why are you using AR? I don't get it. And she just kept hammering at it, like, well, you know, maybe this is in the future when we experience flyers in AR space and potentially even like VR space. And I was like, okay, you know, I kind of like, so I again, as a teacher, I'm just like, all right, let's think about the whys, and if this is in the near future, how is my body, right? Like now that it's superimposed, it's augmented reality, it's superimposed in reality, how am I playing around with this? Where do I see it? And I think And this is her next step. So I'm gonna let her actually talk about the next steps. She did a whole bunch of exercises of just like putting type in augmented reality and just kind of like looking at height, looking at distance, just a lot of like what would be normally like 2D graphic design grid work. She did that in 3D space. But this is where I think it gets pretty exciting, is her next steps.
I also want to like move away from the traditional X and the Y and like look at spaces that would like provide for more unique elevation, or use the facades of a building as a grid. For example, this church, like it would make for such an interesting grid, right? Like imagine a pro-choice poster on this church.
Right? This is where I'm like, yes, AR. Yes, you got it, Rashi. And this was like, this to me sold. I was like, yes, now you're looking at buildings as a grid. Beautiful. And when she, and actually she didn't show me this until her final project, literally until her final presentation. And I just wanted to hug her. I was like, yes, this is it. Like, and but she had to go through all of the iterations of like, YAR, type in space, go through all of the process to even just start thinking about like, oh, right, this is a grid, the facade of a building. And then just super love. I want this as a poster. So that's one example. Here's another brilliant thesis student called Weiwei. And Weiwei from the very beginning wanted to do a VR experience for a friend who committed suicide due to depression. Very heavy subject. I was like, okay, right? Like she knew what she wanted. She came straight away and was like, I want to do this in VR. Again, why VR? We had tons of conversations about that. But this is like super inspiring just to think about like the animation in VR. She also convinced me, now I'm getting a VR headset, right? Wild times. I didn't think I was ever gonna do that. But just like really beautiful, brilliant storytelling. And let's see if I can just grab a little clip of it. Hold on, let me just go to project website and I'll show you a little bit of that. And basically this is a love letter to her friend who passed away, and just trying to think about memory and upholding his memory. And they had a whole group of friends, you know, and that when he committed suicide, you know, just like really devastated everyone, and people are asking, what could I have done? And so this was a lot of like this beautiful animation, like meditation on what it means to lose someone because of depression. And I'll just zoom in a little bit here, or fast forward, I'm saying zoom in.
Back to the chat for the latest work you posted so that I could read it, like it, and share it. I saw that you gained a following and even had your own internet fans. It delighted me to see how much you have progressed. Maybe because no success is without its setbacks. Around that time, I also noticed that you seemed less happy, not as laughter bound as before. Our friends were all a bit worried. But by then, we had grown apart and weren't there for each other as much anymore. At the time, we didn't really know what we could do to help. According to Coco, my favorite animated movie, death is not the end of life, but forgetting is. I couldn't agree more. My memory of you stands as vivid as it was yesterday. And it feels like you're still with us, only that it's been a while since we had messaged or drawn with each other. Although I know that my thoughts cannot change the past, I do think about what I would do if I could go back in time. I will let you know, I will make you believe that you are doing so well, that your audience loves you and your work, and that you achieve everything you wanted in life. The world is big, life is long, and perhaps your apple is waiting just around the next corner.
And the idea was that one of the quotes, or her last conversation with him, is he was trying to describe his depression to her, and he said, you know, it's like being in an island where you have pineapples, bananas, mangoes, all these other fruits, and all you really want is an apple. And so, you know, dedicating this piece and really like thinking about this dream landscape in VR, I thought was a beautiful example. And then I'm going to show this last piece. Oh, these are two really good ones. Sorry, I love these students. But this last piece I'll show is from, actually, if I had to choose one, Lord, all right, I'll show a physical one. This is Elias, who was my thesis student last year, and he was really thinking about musical interfaces and how to really create a almost like embodied idea of timbre and how you change timbre in music. And
I already had a sense of.
So let's start maybe here. Let's think. Okay.
The randomize button also gives that element to like spark inspiration. It's kind of like unique. It's like completely random and unique. Here.
So he created a digital interface of something called Abacusynth. And just thinking through how you could just like even manipulate shapes to create music and to change the timbre of a sound.
I asked a bunch of friends to create music with it, also doubling as like a playtest, and to I compiled it in an album, which is on Bandcamp, listen to it. So yeah, you can find all these links and stuff. And if you don't have Ableton, you can still play an online web version of it. So now onto the physical version, which is what I spent this semester developing. My goal was to create an instrument that someone could interact with directly, as opposed to the software where you need a computer, you need like general computer knowledge. And since the original inspiration was a physical object anyway, I already had a sense of like how it could work. Here's how it sounds.
Watch this for hours. I know you can too. So I'm going back and end with one. I really hope that I know I went through a lot of these examples really quickly, but I hope that you could get a sense of like what it means or how we're thinking about technology as an embodied experience, right? Not just as like learning code or perhaps, you know, and again, not to downplay the idea of like technology as a job. It is a real job, right? And it does afford a lot of people upward mobility, but also like creativity. So it's no shade to that, but rather just thinking about tech, not just as solely a career, but the idea of tech leadership and tech thought and tech storytelling is what ITP really strives for. And so don't do this, don't be that person, right? Where like, this data is like the worst thing ever, but I wanted to end there because don't be that person. There's just like so many better ways to design and think through very important things that are happening today that could like very well convince people to vote for the wrong person or just like tell the story that's actually not happening. So don't be that person. Thank you all so much for this talk.